So I'm Simon DeDeo. I'm external faculty here at the Santa Fe Institute, and I'm also a professor at Indiana University, where I work in computer science and also in the cognitive sciences. We'll be talking in this unit about renormalization. So I actually did my PhD in physics years and years ago, and it's fair enough to say that since 1950, the most interesting thing, in fact, perhaps the only thing that has driven theoretical physics has been the problem of renormalization. And in pursuit of understanding what on earth that was, we developed an enormous amount of extremely complicated mathematics. When I came to work in the cognitive sciences, when I came to study social systems and social behavior, what I realized is that the tools that we had developed in physics for renormalization, and in fact, not just the tools, but the underlying concepts, became incredibly useful for trying to understand a very different kind of problem. And that's because renormalization is a general set of tools for how theories simplify. It's a set of tools to tell you how to throw out information about the world, how to throw out things you may not know, you may not be able to know, and how to throw out things, in fact, you may not even care about, to throw out the stuff that you think is irrelevant. And renormalization is a story about what happens when you do that, what happens not just to the observations you make about the world, but also to the theories that you use to explain those observations. So an example, certainly not from the physical sciences, would be the problem of macroeconomics. So every few months, or every 6 months, or every year, or every 10 years, macroeconomists take a snapshot of the state of the economy. They try to figure out who's employed, who's unemployed, where are the pockets where people are developing new businesses, where are the pockets that are contracting, where people are losing their jobs, and where people are leaving. So the macroeconomists take a snapshot of the economy at different points in time. So there's a 2008 snapshot, a 2009 snapshot, a 2010 snapshot, all the way up to 2016 and beyond. And if you study macroeconomics, your basic job is to look at a snapshot here and to look at the unemployment numbers, right? The number of people who are employed, let's say. You might look at the GDP, you might look at the Gini coefficient, a measure of inequality. Depending upon the kind of macroeconomist you are, you have a small set of variables here. And if you have a good macroeconomic theory, it's going to tell you what happens next year. And if your theory is really good, it might even tell you what happens the year after that. So that's macroeconomics, but we know, of course, that something like the number of people who are unemployed is not what you would think of as a fundamental variable in the same way, let's say, the electric field is a fundamental variable, or the pH of a solution in your blood is a fundamental variable. This, in fact, is a summary of an incredibly complicated and messy world that people inhabit. Okay? And moment to moment, certainly not year to year, every second, people in the actual economy are making deals, they're trading money, okay? They're hiring each other. They're hiring each other, they're getting jobs, they're losing jobs, right? They may even hire people who have skirts, like this, okay? And so in fact, the actual story of how the economy works is a series of second by second accounts of everything that happens within, let's say, the United States. Or indeed everything that happens within the global economy, within the aspects of human behavior that we think of as economic. And so what macroeconomics does is in fact attempt to summarize everything that's going on in the economy at one point in time and build a theory about what's going to happen next, operating only with these variables here. Okay? But the actual reality of the situation is far more complicated, and at the end of 2009, let's say, when the indicators come out, that's the product, in fact, of many, many evolutionary steps, just second by second moments in the history of actually what happened. So, if we had godlike powers, right? If we had machines that could know everything and predict everything, we would have no need for this up here. All we do is we look at the world as it is, okay? And then we'd evolve it forward in time through some sort of massive 8 billion person strong agent-based model. And occasionally, if somebody for some reason said, oh, what's the unemployment going to be in 2009? Well, we just take a snapshot of the system much later, summarize it, okay, and get a new set of statistics here. The problem is not only is operating at this level impossible, It's also perhaps not even useful, because even if our computer could simulate step by step what happens in the world, it may not focus our attention on what actually matters, right? So one person, let's say, gets a job in one part of the country. How important is that? If we're a policymaker, for example, should we intervene here, or should we intervene here, or should we intervene here? One thing that macroeconomics has going for it is not just simplicity, the number of equations a good macroeconomic theory might need to go from here to here is much smaller than the massive number of equations you'd need to go from here to here to here every step along the way. Not only is the macroeconomist more efficient, but it may be the case that these higher level variables are somehow more useful, more explanatory. And of course, we do this all the time. So if you're a cognitive scientist, if you're, say, somebody interested in the psychology of human decision making, you know, in fact, that the account you build has pretty much the same relationship to the firing of neurons in somebody's brain that macroeconomics has to all of the complexity of everything that actually is going on in the economy itself. And so, in fact, many scientific subjects are fundamentally doing this kind of science. They're constantly projecting, or, and this is the word that will come up over and over in this set of modules, or they're coarse-graining this underlying complicated reality to produce a set of good descriptions, okay? And not just to produce a set of good descriptions, but in fact to produce a theory that relates those descriptions as they evolve over time. The relationship between this level and this level is the story of renormalization, and what we'll do here is give you a series of examples that will slowly build up in complexity for how that works.